more excite people.
Well, you're fools.
Well, you. No, really. I have a friend in North Carolina named Dan Collins, and he said you were on the first show he did with Carol Burnett.
Oh, the first show, okay.
And he said, please, the first show that he did, please say hello to Richard. So Dana, if you're there.
Oh, I see. So that's the Skype, and that's looking at me.
Yeah,
so I have to look at me, too. Yeah. I hate looking at me. Well, I know I can, but nevertheless, I'm there, and I can't take my eyes off me, and I hate it. That's why if there's a mirror across from me, you know, right, I always sit on the other side. I don't like to look at me. I don't like to look at my feelings.
I'll stand over here and look at me. No, but this is, Richard asked me what he should talk about, and I said, whatever is on your mind. We both did. I heard Richard's podcast with Gilbert Gottfried, and it was so interesting. I mean, I love Gilbert. Just let you ramble.
Yeah, and that's something I put.
Okay. And there is nothing that you would need to preface this with, nothing except what's on your mind, and these are all
okay. I just have a couple of questions. What are you up here for? What do you do? Why are you? I don't know anything about the past. I don't know what a retirement. That's all I know. And that he's filled with advice, information, talent. That he's a mensch. So why is there anybody?
You were here to learn how to make a living as a writer and to learn the business and how to.
The business being the business.
Right.
And so it's not books, it's as playwrights or as TV writers or movie writers.
Well, it's everything. If writing for television, and we chose television because that's where the careers are, if that is the liftoff, and if you write for television, you can write for, obviously, film and theater. It's so.
And I forgive me, teacher. I don't necessarily believe that. I believe if you can write for theater, you can write for anything. In much way, if you can act Shakespeare, you can act sitcom, you can act anything. I believe that in theater, you don't have the luxury of editing. If a scene, the best example is Monty Python. If they couldn't finish a scene, they just cut it and went to something else, and even made fun of the way that they could not finish a scene. But in theater, you start a scene, and it has to progress until the end and have a purpose and be entertaining and tell you about what's going on. In TV, when I did Spin City, a lot of times my scenes were a quarter of a page long. They just had to escalate my storyline, either to a joke or nothing. Whereas Mike Fox, properly, because he was the star of the show, and that's what people tuned in, would have four or five page scenes, and his story escalated because four or five page scenes collectively makes a show. Mine was just little bits that added up to what was in essence a joke without really an emotional heart. All right, so what else? Yes, go ahead.
Because I graduated with a playwright and screenwriting major. So my first foundation, Cindy Purchase.
Okay.
So my first foundation was theater, and in full-length plays and plot and development and character. I found it's really benefited me a lot to study with Norman, because my ultimate goal is to write, produce, and direct for television, but to go more of the Sam Shepard route, where I'm writing for the theater and writing for film or TV.
Well, that's the way. I pray to God that you hold true to your promise.
And so that I do draw from theater and understanding the development.
You did or you did not?
I do draw a lot from theater.
Okay.
And I find it makes it easier to write for television or
it does.
For screenwriting.
I would believe
strong
that.
Theatrical foundation. Mm-hmm. And so that's why I'm here today. And one of the questions I had for you was, as an actor, what do you look for in a script when you're looking for a character, and why you would even want to be a particular, to choose to even be part of that?
Much too nice a question.
Okay.
Most of the time I get offered something and I say, yes, I'll do it because I need a paycheck, because whatever. So quite honestly, that is what makes me take a part. I wish that I could say, oh, what do I look like? What do I look for? All right, let's start. Let's use that as a jumping point. This is, I'm not saying this to get attention, but I'm friends with George Clooney. And George once said that when he takes a role, an industry starts. Okay? Let's say it's on location. A whole town gets transformed. Tens, maybe hundreds of people come into the town now with employment. The dry cleaner there gets employment. The maid service at the hotels get employment. The cooks and the who do craft service, the background extras, kids who go to high school or elementary school, maybe get put in as extras. They get to see what's going on. The world changes when somebody like that says, I will do a movie. He has a responsibility to that town. He's got a responsibility to the shareholders of the movie company that he says yes to, because if they put in anywhere from 10 to 80 million to, God forbid, 125 million, which is not unheard of, and the movie bombs, like a Ben-Hur or whatever it is, a lot of people lose money because they have stock in Sony or in whatever it is. So there is a lot of responsibility. We're talking about 10 to 20 people in the world, okay? So our perception of showbiz is very different. I'm a working actor. I'm a character actor, okay? I'm a gun for hire. And I usually get one or two scenes per show that may be very, very good. And because of my quote-unquote elevated stature in this industry, okay, I'm getting offered a good couple of scenes or in a TV show, and I'll say, oh, yes, I see the arc in this. I'll take the job. This sounds fun. Right now, because of the state of entertainment, a character actor like myself gets paid what they call top of show, which means there is a cap to how much a show can afford to pay. I'm talking about a television show. And what they can afford to pay an actor. And if I, in my elevated position, don't want to take it, there's 30 other people who can do the job. Not as well, but they can take the money just as well as I can. And maybe the people will only have to pay half of top of show in case they're getting a lesser actor or somebody who's really hungry. But I get top of show, which is a decent amount of money to all of us, but it doesn't put my kids through private school. I am a gun for hire, okay? So what do I look for in a script? I pray that it has a good arc, that the storyline is clear, that I affect the action that's going on. And sometimes if they know that the script does not have that, then they'll pay me more money because my presence, because I am a known commodity, and because they know that I might be might be able to elevate the product, and they'll push more money on. So sometimes I look for that. Will they pay me more? That's what it is.
So in the same token,
yeah,
what you said about George Clooney, I was working with Bill Cosby when his son was murdered. A tragic situation. And he stayed out, and in the same regard, he came back early. He said, because I'm responsible for everybody here.
That's right.
And it was a very elegant statement. And I have had the greatest tragedy of my life. And he said, I was in a car, and a van passed by, and two women in the van saw me, and they grimaced time, but they felt sad. And he said, I can't have that. My life isn't my life, is with you. So it was a very elegant thing that he did to come back. And he said, I have all these people working.
It's a responsibility. So there are so many things that go on when you make a decision about working. But for somebody like George Clooney or Bill Cosby, it's much more elevated. If you want to know an actor's point of view, and you got to understand that I am an actor for hire, okay? And I do anything. I do radio plays. I've done an opera at New York City Opera. I do plays. I went to London last spring to do Guys and Dolls. I played Nathan in Guys and Dolls in the West End. I like to do it all. I am proud of being a journeyman actor, okay? And are any of you have aspirations for acting? You have aspirations for acting?
Okay.
So I'll address a little bit about that, but I encourage you all, because you're writers, to take an acting class. Or even a cold reading class, and find out what it's like to be up there, maybe an audition class, because you're going to have to see what it's like when an actor enters the room. Either feel for him, either say, hey, look, I could do better than you, and I've done it because I did it, pardon me, in class or whatever. So, and you'll also see the goings-on in an actor's mind when they enter the room. This, believe it or not, is what I think. When I look at a role, and I have an audition, and I am right for this role, I walk in and I say, this is your lucky day. You have got the best. I gotta believe this, and I sometimes really, really do. You have got the best guy for the job. I pray that you hire everybody else around me who can do as good a job as I can do. But I am here, this is important. I want the job, okay? But even more, I know how to take this and make it great. Because these guys don't necessarily want to help me. They don't necessarily want to give me a job. What they want to do is have their script be Seinfeld and make gazillions and gazillions of dollars so they can be rich. Do you understand? They don't give a shit about me. They don't care that I'm paying for my kids' private school. They don't care about anything. They want their project to be great, and they want to make a lot of money. I'm your guy to help you. Place it on them, okay? But most actors go in with that song from the chorus line, oh God, I need this job. Dear God, I need this job. Oh, let me get this job. There are lots of jobs. There are opportunities. But if you think you are right, if you can walk into that room knowing you have talent and that you're right for this role, I'm your guy. On the flip side, there's 30 guys behind you who can do just as well, probably just different. I once went to an audition for a show that was about a rock star, his valet, chauffeur, confidant, assistant. Everybody that I knew everybody in that waiting area. And there were 30 guys. And this was only one day of many days. There were people who were 29, and there were people who were 60. I knew every guy in that room. Everybody. Everybody. We've all been up for stuff before. Not just character actors, young leading men. Anybody guess who got the role?
What are you?
It was not me.
Gary Oldman.
Kim Cattrall. Anybody can play a fucking part. They went with a beautiful woman. There were guys, and they auditioned and auditioned guy after guy. Jeffrey Tambor at the time was not employed. He was there. Let me see some other people who you might, if you know, Stephen Tobolowsky. He was there. I'm talking the young guys, everybody. And they go with, anybody know who was supposed to play Beverly Hills Cop? Anybody know? It was written for Sylvester Stallone. It was written for Sylvester Stallone.
Yeah, you're right.
Anything can happen. Just go on in.
There's a great book now called Powerhouse about about CNN. Mm-hmm. And Ronnie Myers is everybody's friend. And he's my friend too. So sorry. He said he called Stallone, who was this client, and said, "Sly, I got the best offer you ever have. $10 million. Nobody had ever made that kind of money before from Andy Blondian, producer who did The Terminator and stuff. And he said, $10 million. And he said, do you want me to send, Sly said, take it. He said, do you want me to send the script over? And Stallone said, do I kill Christ in it? He said, no. He said, you don't have to
do it. That's hilarious. Oh, I love that. That's hilarious.
I kill Christ.
I'm sure Norman has gone over this, over what the difference between writing for a film is and writing for TV. And I'm sure you all know the difference between single camera, multi-camera, and stuff like that. Yeah, what did you want to say something?
Oh, I was going to ask you, as an actor, when you see fellow actors either holding to the method or technical acting, do you see a similar thing?
I don't listen to any of that shit. Oh, my God. Let's talk about that because this is important. What I was just getting to, and I really don't believe any of that shit. That Daniel Day-Lewis works the way he does, God bless him. Okay, guy, you know, and on Sundays he goes play golf and plays golf as Abraham Lincoln. Good for him. He is the greatest. But are you kidding me? What is the goal of an actor in a single camera show? What is the goal of an actor? Ultimately, what is the goal of an actor on a single camera show? What is the goal? Anybody name it?
Spencer Tracy.
No, that's a good actor.
Say the line.
Yeah, no. That is not the goal. What is the goal of an actor, of a director, of a producer on a single camera show?
Make the show funny.
Tell the crowd.
Tell the story.
Anybody else? Finish the day. And dear God, finish it within the 12 hours that you're allotted. So the actor had better be off book and only have to do each scene twice from one angle so that you can finish the day. How good are you? Fuck who, how good you are. Honest to God, who the hell cares? The writers want their words said, and I guarantee you, only America will only see the words as written. You can make all the decisions you want about, wait, let me give it this way. Look, they'll cut around you, so you won't even be heard. The writer wants the words spoken, and the producers and the network and whoever's paying the bill wants the day finished in 12 hours. Okay? I was lucky enough to work with Kathy Bates. Yeah. I know. And she had to do, she played a lawyer. And it was a David Kelly show. and David Kelly likes every T crossed the way that he crosses and every if, and, but said the way that he wrote it. Most of the time he's right, not all the time. However, that's what he wants. Kathy Baker would come and literally, the speech to the jury was this long. And she did it many times, and she got through it, and she never felt good. And my advice to Kathy Baker, to Kathy Bates, was you've got to get used to the drive home and accepting mediocrity. Because on the drive home, you're going, oh, why didn't I say it like this? Oh my God, it was so good. Because you have no rehearsal, because you got to do it quickly, and she is used to rehearsal. She's used to doing plays in which she rehearses for a month. She's used to doing movies, which usually, because of the budget and the directors that she's probably working with, gets 2 to 3 weeks rehearsal and to talk to them. And the leisure of shooting 2 pages or a page, or am I right? In a movie, 2 pages, yeah. 3 pages a day, as opposed to 11 pages a day. 8 to 11 pages easily. Easily 8 to 11 pages a day on an hour single camera. Job of an actor, memorize your lines, get through the day. And of course we want you to feel, every director and everybody wants you to act it as well as you can. Of course they do. Do that at home. You want to work on it, work on it at home. You haven't got the luxury of time on a set. Gotham shoots, what, a 9-day shoot? Okay, they have 60 pages or 50, whatever it is, to shoot in 8 days, 9 days, okay? Some of the things are stunts, but if they're shooting dialogue, that's the easiest thing in the world. You got the words or you don't got the words. So shoot them that way. Lighting, oh, that's going to take some time. A car chase, whoa, a fight scene. Jeez, we don't know. The dialogue, get it out there. Fine, let's move on. And that's all it is. That's TV. At least network TV. The HBO and the premium channels have a lot more money. They can give you some time, a little more time. Not a lot, but a little more time. It's a hybrid between network TV and movies. Job as an actor, get through the day. And Kathy Bates, who's great, and there's a reason she's great, has to be mediocre, great mediocrity, because she's great. She can't say anything that's a lie. She only tells the truth when she acts. But her job is to get through that speech. That's it. And the drive home can be excruciating. It's an excruciating drive home if you are a perfectionist. TV is not about perfection. Movies try to be, but nowadays with tentpole movies, you know what a tentpole movie is? A movie that's going to come out at Christmas or Thanksgiving or 4th of July weekend or something like that. They'll put out a trailer before the movie is finished. They'll start a movie, am I right?
Yeah.
Before the script is finished. It's because they have a deadline now that we're all expecting Captain America 4 to come out on July 4th. We don't have a script. Oh my God, we don't have a script. I don't care. Get it out by July 4th. Okay? So you're asking very elevated questions about what do we look for. Sometimes the student, the academic, can ask those kind of questions. The producer, I'm telling you to the bottom line, they don't have the luxury of those questions. Does that make sense? Very cynical. I'm quite aware. By the way, my advice to all actors okay? But to all actors, no matter how good you are, even if you had a crystal ball saying you're going to be a huge success, don't be an actor. Do not. Go out and make a lot of money, and if you really love acting, buy a community theater and make the, and do the best roles that you can. Do the great. You really want to act? Really, really act? Play brick and cat on a hot tin roof. Do whatever you can. Make a lot of money. The world is a better place. We don't need any more actors. We just don't. We don't need any more lawyers. We don't need any more actors. There's plenty of people with dreams. By the way, you all know Amadeus, right?
Personally?
Thank you for bringing that, because I get. By the way, here's something else I'm going to say. Whatever I say here today, I say it very strongly because it's how I am. You don't have to believe a word of it. As a matter of fact, I encourage you to argue against me. Not to me, but amongst yourselves. But there are actors. I love, my sister was campaigning for Clinton, and there was a girl from Britain who came and was polling person and tried to help out with the election. And she worked really, really hard. And my sister said, I can't believe that Clinton lost. That Clinton lost and Trump won. She tried so hard. She worked so hard. Tough. I don't care how tough you work as an actor. I don't care the squalor you live in for your art. It doesn't matter. Every actor wants to be a big movie star. It doesn't matter how hard you work. And Mozart was born a genius. Salieri worked much harder than Mozart did, and really worked, and played the game, and you know, Mozart was better. He was just better. And you've got to understand, doesn't matter how hard you work as an artist, either you got it or you don't. I encourage you to work really, really hard and pray that you got it. But just because you're working hard does not mean you will get successful. Does it mean you deserve success? A little bit. Well, I don't think so, but it doesn't mean you're going to get it. Some people are just born better. Just born better. What else? I have so many things. Okay, anybody have questions that will get me started? Go ahead.
So what would you say is the difference between working on a show like when you're on Curb or Spin City with the more network multi-camera? Curb, which was the HBO.
Then I'll get it. Okay. This is tough. I think we're going to go back.
Oh,
I
don't think
we have.
No.
If you're talking about, I do. Right. Again, I want it. But in his head, he's got his story. I don't fit there. What am I going to do? Four camera shoots. When you're in front of an audience, you have four cameras. One shoots this way, one camera shoots that way, this one shoots. Hopefully, this one shoots close-ups. Okay, so that's what's called a four-camera shot. Are you well aware of that? Okay, you have an audience that gives you sort of the rhythm. That is the easiest show in the world. You know who suffers? Who do you think suffers? The director actually isn't easy. It's only have four. Four ways, then as long as we're all shooting, the editor can get it together. The director on a four-camera comedy, he's a camp counselor. He really does nothing. He's a go-between between the office and the actor. Yeah. That's all he does. He does nothing, in my opinion. I hate to say it, but it's a wonderful job, and they're lovely, and they keep things going, keep things up, and mediate Henry Kissinger between the actors and the thing, but otherwise, it's easy. It's really, really, really tough on the writers because here's the schedule of a 5-day situation comedy. Monday morning, you come in 10 o'clock, you read the script. At 10:35, you say goodbye and you go play golf. And the writers go upstairs and they work until 3 o'clock in the morning and they rewrite. And they just rewrite. Oh my God, this didn't work at the table. I need to say the two most important times, there are three important times, of course, the most important time is filming. The two of the most important times is Monday, table read, because they hear what works and doesn't work. The temperature of the room is wrong, people are like this. If the coffee is bad, if they had a tough night the night before, whatever, there's so many variables. The second most important time is what's called camera blocking. So you're on the stage and you sort of show all the cameramen gathered, there are about 15, 20 people, are all gathered around and standing there like this, looking at the actors play out the scene. Okay? If they laugh, you're good. And if they don't laugh, and the cameramen, you know, they're the average Joe, and a lot of times they're not going to laugh anyway. So if you do get a laugh, a decent laugh, good for you. And then, of course, shooting. So anyway, that's Monday. Monday, you read 10, literally 10 o'clock, and you're gone by 10:30. Tuesday, rewrites. Okay? Date, which can be, they could change, they can have one script and it's changed a lot. They can have one script and it's changed to an enormous amount. Of rewrite. I'm going to tell you the side story. Okay. So he could be jokes are put. Oh God, this joke didn't work. But as Gary Goldberg said, who ran Comedy Ties, you want a joke? We got three of them. But whatever joke, don't worry. We got a joke. The heart, caring about the story, caring about the characters. That takes hard work. But any jokes? We got plenty. Norman, yeah, ask Norman. Give me three jokes, Norman. Norman, give me like that. And they're all going to be just as good as the next one. So Wednesday, you block it out. You start at 10 in the morning. If you need to, by 1 o'clock, you've blocked out each scene. All the writers come down. They look at what you got. Oh, God, this didn't work. So they go back and they rewrite until, let's say, 9, 10 o'clock that night, okay? Wednesday, you re-block what you've been doing. You do that, the network comes, the writers come. You act it out, and then they say, oh, this is all good. And they try and solidify. They try, and pretty much 90% usually is. The network really doesn't like what they've seen, and the network is the boss of it all, then you change it a lot. But pretty much you can start memorizing your lines on Wednesday night. Thursday is called camera day. That's when all the cameras, when technical thing, this is your day to become better actors, but the day is made for technical purposes. You got four cameras. This one has to move over here after a bit. Well, oh my God, it's got to move back. What does this camera do? And it becomes a ballet and they mark it so that you see what's going on. And then you have the sound guy with a boom up above. Oh my God, where this is going over here and I'm walking over there, but the guy is walking over here. So how do they trace that with a boom overhead? All technical things that everybody in this room does not want to touch. It gets our hands dirty. We don't like it at all. That's all technical stuff. It goes on, I'm aware of it, but we don't like it. So that Thursday is all for that. And then Friday, you do it again. Practice, 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 and then you do it in front of the easiest thing for the actor in the world. Yeah, in essence, Monday and Tuesday off. Wednesday, you have to start working. Thursday is boring, and then Friday, you better come. That's showtime. A simple camera show is hard on the actors. You start early in the morning, you start at 6 o'clock in the morning, and they're given a 12-hour day, usually. And for a half hour, very rarely you get more than 5 days to shoot. Okay? So, you start at 7 in the morning. If it's a long script, you go 14, 15, and 16 hours. It's a long day, and the actors sit there, and they wait. So if the camera's shooting this, okay, if we have the U2 in the shot, we're going to shoot it this way, then we're going to get your reaction, then we're going to get your reaction, okay? Well, you're in different lighting. Right now, you're in better lighting than more. Maybe you just start or close your eyes. We have to light you different. Lighting is so subtle and fluid, and I know nothing about it, but it all has to be set up and made to look pretty. And if the director wants to get creative, he'll shoot it in different ways. Maybe the camera will move. Maybe it's a walking shot. Maybe you guys get up. If you kind of forget, you guys get up. Then we got to change the lighting to where you're going to walk to. And if it's five people in a shot, like you often have a Gotham, you're going to get everybody's shot. So that's five different meaning. It's everything. It's that's a long day. That's easy on the writers. The writers say, this is your script, go and shoot it.
But talk about the show. That was a wonderful show with a phenomenal cast with Dustin Hoffman.
Okay.
And the ingredient that talk about waiting was the creator, writer,
okay.
Producer.
I can get into the politics of it, and I address.
But just the relationship between you as an actor in that cast and a writer who was had difficulty delivering, if I'm not mistaken, having the words on it, having
wasn't
the scene.
It wasn't entirely that. So I'll clarify. I understand. You all know who David Milch is. The greatest of wordsmithing.
A genius.
A true genius. And when I say this, I am literal. Like Shakespeare. I am literal. He spoke in a poetry that we do not speak in. He references Billy Budd and Melville and Faulkner. If you've ever read Faulkner, who's going all of it, that's how David Milch writes. David Milch was known. Example was one told me on the Northwest, whatever the show I did with. He would come down to the set with rewrites. The rewrite said, well, the show was supposed to take place in the post office. Oh my God, they want to change it to the whorehouse. But we've got the post office. Yeah, don't worry. Here's different lines for you. But it takes a while to memorize these lines. You're the actor who can handle it. You can do it. And I'm telling you, it was like memorizing Shakespeare. You must understand, especially when you're talking and referencing horse racing, which does not come easily to me because I'm not so knowledgeable about horse racing. HBO had worked with David Milch on Deadwood. They knew what he was like. So they got somebody who was very strong to produce the show, okay? The guy who produced the show, wonderful writer, brilliant director, meticulous, was a man who was even more nuts than David Milch. His name was Michael Mann. Michael Mann once built, I think he built for what's the Johnny Depp movie about this, the gangsters? Public Enemies. Built $1 million set with a place for a crane to come, and he saw it and he went, I don't like it. And it was scrapped. $1 million. I'm not kidding when I say this about Michael Mann. The best example I can give is he once had his assistant call United Airlines and say, Mr. Mann is running late. Would you hold the plane? This is the ego and the outlandish sense of self that this guy has. He had no regard for money, people, or time. Nothing. Nothing. Our shows, we were given, where would I say it? Sitcom was given 5 days. Gotham was probably given 8 or 9 days. We were given 16 days to shoot a show. And more than once, the show ran 24 days. Okay? He had a scene, if you've ever seen it, a scene inside a yacht, okay? Inside a yacht. How much do you think it costs to rent a yacht for a day?
Not cheap. Well, not something I have.
$10,000
Oh, depending on the speed, a big yacht. It costs $80,000 a day. Okay. Now, you want to build an insider yacht? $100,000 to build the most beautiful set you can. But they used it for a lot of episodes, some days twice an episode. That's a lot of money. And it's indoors. That was outdoors with a camera that floats in and maybe go. It was indoors. Why couldn't you build the set? Because he did not care. So if you want to know why that show was canceled, it was the extravagance and hubris of somebody who said, we got Dustin Hoffman, we got Dennis Farina, we got Nick Nolte, we're going to David Milch. Please, let's do it right. And it was hubris. It was not that successful. It was successful for those who liked it. But people hear that it was shut down because of the horses. It was not. It was shut down because of the horse's ass. Okay? And that's the truth. Okay? It had nothing to do with the death of horses. Horses die. They just die, and not that many died. So it was ridiculous. But that's the excuse that HBO used. It was a wanton waste of money. If you're as successful as Game of Thrones, spend the money, it doesn't matter. You were not as successful as Game of Thrones, okay? So therefore, that show cut down. But Michael shoots beautifully, and he writes beautifully, and David Milch wrote beautiful, beautiful scripts, and it was acted to perfection by everybody. But it didn't work. Now, any other questions about that?
No, I like the relationship between writer and actor.
Okay, I can actually tell you more of the relationship between writer and actor. Michael Mann, the director, was so in control that during the shooting of the pilot, David Milch was on set. Was talking to me, and he was describing my character as there was a stutterer in the book Billy Budd, and he was he's very literate. He knows literature. He's brilliant. Fucked up beyond anybody's imagination, and he'll admit it. But he's talking to me about the character, and Michael Mann comes over, grabs him by the arm, pulls him over to the side and says, and this is literal words, don't you ever fucking talk to an actor of mine on set. And David Milch, who was banned from the set, he never came to the set during the entire shooting of the season. The entire. So, there's also a story that was told that cracks me up that David got so upset one night that he grabbed a baseball bat. This was staying because he lived in a town. He stayed at David's house. And supposedly, Moses was going over to bash Michael Mann's head in. And he came in and kicked open the door. And there's Michael Mann at the editing bay, turning around, looking at the guy at the editing, turning around. And I had no idea. But there's all sorts of stories. So, anyway, what else?
Go ahead.
I open up.
Go ahead.
We're given a script for a TV show. Is there anything you could tell, like in the script, where you could just tell that the writer is a rookie or like really skilled professional?
I can't put my finger on it, but yes, I can. When I auditioned, let me tell you the story about auditioning for Sin City. Gary David Goldberg had a show called Champs. It was all about five guys. It was sort of like that championship season, if you ever know the play that championship season. It was about five old friends who were champion basketball players, and they remained friends, which is Gary's story, because he was a great basketball player, actually hired most of his writing staff. By the way, they played basketball, and they were all young kids. Go out and play with them. It's another story. In any case, so he had this show, and I wanted to audition for it. Gary said, I know Richard Kind, I know him from Mad Guys too. I think he's great. He's not right for the show. Couldn't get an audition. Could not even get an audition to me. Give me 10 minutes. I'll go and I'll show you how to do it. You don't have to hire me. Give me the chance. Wouldn't hire me. Spin City rolls around, his chance lasts about a season. Spin City rolls around maybe 2 years later. Want to audition for it? Richard Kind's not right. Bill Lawrence, who was co-writing with Gary, knew me, thought I might be. I got the audition. I went in, I asked. You get to a certain point where you don't have to. Here's the hierarchy. You go in and you audition for the casting director. The casting director says, oh, you're good. I like you. I want you to meet the writers. You go in, you meet the producers and the writers, you do an audition for them. In order to get the part, you get to get their approval, and you also have to get the network's approval. Well, I'm far beyond going to a casting director in my career. They don't know my work, well, shame on them. But I requested a meeting with the casting director. Maybe she could give me some pointers. Here I am, taking a chance. Gary didn't go, but didn't want me before. Let me try to go in and do that. She thinks I'm good. I went in for the writers. And I said, if I get called back, this is so, there's such hubris to this. If I get called back, the part is mine. If I don't get called back, it's because they got too many Jews on the show. It's too early. I think that Michael J. Fox is too short. They'll never catch me in the same camera. Whatever it is. If I get called back, the part is mine. And I was right. And it was the biggest pilot of that year because it was really well written. Can't answer any questions. They just knew it. You knew how good this was. It's Michael J. Fox and Gary David Goldberg. The chances of it going for more than 13 or more than a year even are great. And so it was the pilot to get that year. Every once in a while, you get a pilot that has a lot of buzz. This was the pilot that year. And I got it. So do you know? I've never been offered it. Yeah, there was one thing, but I had to turn it down for a specific reason. Van Wilder. Remember the movie Van Wilder? I was offered a part in that, but I couldn't do it. That's one that I wish that I was available. But otherwise, I got no other stories like that. I'm always available. We'll work it out, something like that. But can I tell? I don't think I can. Can somebody else tell? I think Norman can.
But I always wondered what the ride, when you talk about the ride back,
yeah.
You audition. Uh-huh. And I was very sensitive to actors, and I know they're going back.
Yeah.
I did lousy, I did well, I'm not getting this, I'm getting this. So when they're not getting it, I always tell them, I said, you're not going to get this. I make up an excuse. But you're not getting this because we're going
for it. Yeah.
And
oh my God! I mean, nowadays with the backlash of what happened with the Academy Awards last year, every next door neighbor,
yeah.
Which I used to play, is going to go to a black man. It's going to. That's part of the demands. I'm looking at you, unfortunately, because you're there and I'm walking back. But nevertheless, I believe yes.
Right.
But it's going to go to a person of color. And or maybe even now to a woman, but I don't think we have anything to say about that after the election. But in any case, there are so many variables.
Yeah.
So many variables. And you just you don't know them. A lot of times when you do a take, and they say, okay, let's move back to one. They think, oh, what have I done wrong? What have I done wrong? You don't know, but the cameraman may have hiccuped, and they have to do it again. But I'm an actor, I'm a Jew, I'm neurotic and insecure, and I'm going to say, it was my fault. But it's not. The cameraman hiccuped, or was out of focus a little bit. But you think it's your fault. These are just things, I don't know, these won't help you. These are just things that go on in my head.
Yeah.
I'm also, me, very candid and honest parts that I will go up for that I think I'm all wrong for. So I can sometimes if the words, here's something, if the words don't seem to come out of my mouth with ease, then I can see that it's not for me. I was supposed to do just a reading of a new version of the Nutcracker, but it's a lot like Papa. What are you doing? And I just said, you know, I can't serve this. I can't serve this correctly. Here's the story about Seinfeld, which is sort of funny, but there was an episode of Seinfeld in which they had a guy's in. More coffee? There was an episode of Seinfeld in which the character that I was auditioning was sitting next to Jerry Seinfeld on an airplane. And I didn't think I was right for the role. And at the time, this is a movie you guys probably either don't remember, and you certainly won't remember this to see, but there was a movie out called The Accidental Tourist. And the guy who, in the beginning of The Accidental Tourist, is this regular Joe businessman sitting next to William Hurt. He was a heavy guy by the name of Brad Mott. I happened to go to school with him. At the time, The Accidental Tourist was out. I go into the audition, and I say, you know who you should hire? You should hire Brad Mott, because it's sort of a joke on The Accidental Tourist, being that Jerry's sitting next to this guy. I thought it might be funny, and he'd be great for the role. The casting director, honest to God, said, Brad isn't available. Okay? That is such a lie, because he lives in Chicago. Say, oh, that's a good idea, but it was just the most ridiculous thing in the world. My response was, well, I'm by far the second best choice. And I got the role, but I wasn't right for it. Go to rehearsal. This is something interesting. I was young at the time. We do the table read on Monday morning. It's in the studio. The table goes from this wall to that wall. It's that long. I'm way down at the other end. Jerry's here. I'm supposed to have this intimate conversation sitting next to him on an airplane. And they're never going to hear me. I got to yell my lines. I was no good. And I'm telling you that everybody was there because Seinfeld was a hit. Everybody wanted to come by, from the network executives to everybody wanted to be in on Seinfeld. And on Monday mornings, there was an omelet bar. The food was phenomenal. We do think nothing I said got a laugh. And I was like the donkey going after the carrot, trying to just, the more I didn't get it, the more I tried. It was horrible. The director was a guy named Tom Chironis. He used to direct all the beginning Seinfelds, and I had worked with him before. And I go, Tom, I'm not right for this role. You need to fire me. Go ahead. It's okay. I know I get paid. I'm not right for it. No, you're great. You're great. Larry David, who I knew a little bit, I knew him, came down. I said, Larry, I'm not right for this. And he goes, no. The next day, I find out they're going to change him into a drunk. Okay, the character's going to be drunk. I go, I did an audition for this. I know I'm not like, no, you're fine. They ended up not, it's as bad as Sylvester Stallone playing Beverly Hills Cop. An actor you probably know, Joe Mahar. Remember Joe Mahar?
Yeah.
They went from me to Joe Mahar. Joe Mahar was a white-haired, very elegant, effete Englishman. As far as you could get from me. And was brilliant on the show, by the way. And that's who they hired. They replaced me. So
I cast them as King Richard.
And yes, in the Brotherhood. Yes, of course, right. He's a great actor.
Yeah.
He just as a side note, he once, this is funny, oh my God, I'm mentioning George Clooney twice. I don't see that. I don't. I promise you I don't. But I went to see a play called Root by Joe Orton, who's one of the great comic playwrights. Joe Mahar was sort of Jason Robards was to Eugene O'Neill, Joe Mahar was to Joe Orton. And he's doing this role, and he's playing a detective. And he literally went, I saw the performance in LA. He was a detective, and he went like this. Ah ha! Now, who in the world does that? You ever see anybody do that? The audience roared for a minute. And I'm there with George Clooney. He and I went to see the play. I'm like, I'm going to tell him. And we talked. I said, that's the kind of actor I want to be. George said, me too. I am a good. George did not. But I will always remember. He was just such a brilliant actor. Because we're talking about the writing, and I do encourage you all to try your hand at playwriting, because if you have a scene, well, a lot of times when you write a movie, you're writing right from your guts, this is what I want to do. But if you have a budget that's less than $1 million, you can only have so many locations. You can have only so many actors in your movie and leads. And you want a big crowd scene in Washington, D.C., like Forrest Gump? Got to cut that scene. So these are things that you have to think about when you're writing. And as young writers, you don't think about those things at all. And why I say theater writing is because you can pour out your heart, and every word has to be important, or else it's boring. Can't cut, you're right, you're there. The whole scene, and a scene, if you're gonna have a scene, usually minimum 7 minutes. You gotta write people talking and starting at point A and going to point C within 7 minutes. That's really, really, really hard. It's really hard. And if you can do that, I think you can write anything. You can write TV. And the theater needs people like that. I really believe, and I believe TV and movies need people like that. TV now is truly the golden age, so much so that it's better than movies. It's unbelievable. And they write for cable in ways that the information isn't spoon-fed. In Breaking Bad or in Fargo, a lot of times you're given behavior and you go, why? Why does this person do that? And then one episode or two episodes later, you're given the explanation of why he did. I happen to like that. I don't think you have to lay out on a silver platter why somebody is the way that they are. Have a behavioral, and then I wish I could think of an explanation or an example, I mean, and I can't. But more and more, that's what's happening. We just are not spoofing. Let me see, is there anything in The Night Out? Oh, right, I do. Everybody see The Night Out?
Yeah.
Oh, we see The Night Out.
Well, I'm just on episode 4, but
this is what happens.
We'll tell you all about season 2.
Yeah.
Michael Patrick, what's his name? Patrick Williams, the boxer who
was
Michael Capone. Wants this, as from what I see, wants this kid. Well, I thought it was because he was gay. I thought he was, you know, I thought that's what he wanted. He wanted this little boy. And it takes an entire episode, and I think 2 episodes, to discover why he, according to what, don't tell me anything more. From what I saw, is because he's smart. He wants a college education. That that blew me away. It thrilled me. But you weren't, he wasn't called up immediately because, oh, I want somebody to talk to or I want to learn things. It just came out. And also, how did it come out? In Call of the Wild, which many, many writers think is Jack London, the terseness, the greatness of his writing. That was great. So rather than write from the first second, having them come down and say, I want you because you're smart, it took two episodes for you to think this guy wants to sleep with him. That's what I thought. Why else would he want him? I just thought, that's good writing to me. And it keeps you in suspense. It keeps you wondering, what's going on? What's going on? What? They're burning his head. Oh my God, what's going on?
So, two world-class writers.
Yeah, absolutely, yes. Absolutely. Yeah. Price and Zalian.
Yeah.
None better in the world.
Yeah.
None better. Along with LeBravanes, I think they're the greatest.
Yeah.
So good.
Other questions?
Yes, I can talk.
Tell me your time.
I got until 6 o'clock.
Okay,
so I'm
hours.
And I love to talk. That's the killer. And it's just, you know, one thing that you got to know about me is I really love what I do. I really do. If you guys get up in the morning and write, and you love to write, oh my God bless you, because I don't. I used to give you an example of how much I like writing versus not. I used to be at Second City. Now at Second City, you write. Okay, I don't have to sit down in a typewriter alone. I got an audience to tell me what's funny, and I got some other people to bounce it off of, and that's how I can write. Doing what you're doing, and that whole thing of, well, I wake up at 5 and I give myself 3 hours and then my day starts, you know, but I write for 3 hours. I'm flabbergasted. I truly, truly am. I am flabbergasted by that blank piece of paper. I don't understand. I just couldn't do it. But acting, give it all up to act. And I do give it all up. I do plays. I play for Roundabout Theater, nominated for a Tony Award, the whole bit. $900 a week. That's my technique, $900 a week. That does nothing for me on the 82nd and Broadway. And with three kids and a dog. Yeah.
Okay. You do a lot of like voice acting too. Mm-hmm. Do you like appreciate like, or I guess like pay more attention to like the script when you have to be worried about being seen? Like, you enjoy your voice acting, like reading script in the story, because it's just like,
a lot of times you don't get to read the script. Okay, just to read your scenes. Mm-hmm. This is just an acting thing. Here you see me. I'm walking around. I gesticulate, everything like that. With voice acting, you're right here. You got no hands, you got no eyes, you got nothing except your voice. It's crazy, it's exhausting. You wouldn't think it. It's exhausting. Now, I had people go, oh my God, I'd love to do voiceovers. I'm dying out of it. Who, what? You can show up in your pajamas. You don't have to shave. It's an easy gig. But it actually is tough. I think tough because you only do it for an hour or two. But a lot of times I get winded because I'm so concentrated. Just so, so concentrated. Acting on stage, it's going like this to the corners of the house. Acting from camera is going like this. All right here. So it's like the opposite of a microphone. Microphone is like this. And why you can play Shakespeare on stage and therefore do anything is that you can emote and be, and these are my expressions. This is my emotion. This is what I'm saying. And I'm getting it out there. And there is a freedom. I'm much better with that freedom than I am from the as a joke, when I worked with Unluck with Nick Nolte, I used to call Nick Nolte what actor, because I would talk like this, and I'm talking to you, and you can all hear me. Anybody hear me?
What?
Yeah, I used to say, what? Until I called him a what actor, because he's right here. The microphone picks up everything, because it's right here. It's right under my tongue. There's the microphone. And I'm sitting across a bar, a people in a bar. I cannot hear. I can't hear what he said, but I knew his lines and I could tell from his expression. But I don't talk like that. I talk like this. Even if I'm sitting across from him, I talk this. That's still mad. And this coming all. Also, in acting for stage, in a movie, you've got 110 page script. But today we're doing page 69. It's the first day we're shooting page 69. Do I really know? Have I made all of the decisions about what goes on from page 1 to 68? I have. What if they're different? What if they're different? I'm still going in on page 69. And I better pray that everything that I've done leading up to it on the first day of shooting now, we're shooting at the. But in theater, you come, take a look at Max Bialystock from the producers. The life this guy leads. Or you look at Willie Loman, or he starts out as this guy, and then by the end of the night, he kills himself. Okay? You get to go and live this guy's life. Every night, it's exhausting. But you get to do that journey in that night. So you're filled with knowledge, and you can feel the audience, and there's a relationship that you have as the actor, to the character, to the audience. And that to me is easier, but you go in and you start with a sequel. Where am I coming from? Oh my God, I had an argument with my wife today, and now I've got to do that. It's very difficult how you feel it versus the day that you do the first page, the third page. It's just an interesting thing. And the voiceover, look, I did Inside Out. I was in the hands of great, great, great people. And, I've done 5 Pixar movies. Been lucky. Been on. A gift I couldn't ask for more. I'm going to live down. I'm going to live in history. I will live the test of time. I'm Jiminy Cricket. it's unbelievable because it's so brilliant. Funny thing to tell you, what goes through my head. I heard that Pete Tucker went to John Lasseter, who knows me, and I believe the only reason that I was ever in Bug's Life is because my character's name on Spin City is Paul Lasseter, and John Lasseter, who did that movie, his father and his son's name is Paul Lasseter. I believe that's the only reason that I ever inside out, because I got to do Bug's Life. In any case,
that's why you got on.
I do believe that's why he may have known me even more, is because my character's name was Paul Lasseter. In any case, I do Bugs Life, I do a good job. John loves me, and I love John. He's great, and he's an innovative pioneer, and a great, great man. In any case, Pete Docter went into John Lasseter, head of Disney, and said, here's what I want for Bing Bong, Richard Kahn. Johnny said, great. What I understand was between me and Bill Murray. Okay, I think that I'm the better choice, as great as a hero as Bill Murray is, because there's more of an openness and there's nothing cynical about what I put in my performance. I don't think Bill Murray, as great as he is capable of anything like that. However, there's a lot of people who could have the role. In any case, first day, first, so I sort of knew that Pete wrote it with me in mind. It's really something. I go in and I do the first take. That is the scariest moment, because what if the part that was written for you, with you in mind, and you go do it, and they go, and you're replaceable up to the day before that movie opens, because you know they don't need makeup or do the sets again, they can just re-record you. But the minute that they left, I knew I was in my flint, so I was fine. But that to me is the scariest moment. And to be honest, you know, I did about 8 sessions over 2 years for Inside Out. This is, I think, the last session. I had lots of stories. Did I? when I did Bugs Life. Okay, so I'm at a party years ago, and Kevin Spacey's at the party. I love Kevin Spacey. He'd just come out with Usual Suspects. I had done a reading with him once before. He knew me. He knew me enough. He might even know my name, but just in case, I'm practicing to myself at the party. Mr. Spacey, Richard Kind, we worked together before. We have mutual friends. Just want to tell you, Usual Suspects is just fantastic. It's just so good. And all of a sudden, there's a tap on the shoulder. And I turn around and he goes, "Hey, Rich, we play brothers in a movie." I played brothers in A Bug's Life, but I never worked with him. Okay, so his face was not in my consciousness, just his character was, but his character's a grasshopper, so I don't know. So that's who I was talking to when I was recording. So the last session of Inside Out, worked with nobody. This was going to be with Amy Poehler. So I'm going to go in, I'm going to work with Amy Poehler. In my head, here's what I'm thinking. They're the nicest guys in the world, people at Pixar. They all love me. They love me. I'm not doing the job right. They're giving me one more chance. Let's record with Amy Poehler and see if he can do it. Maybe that'll get him to be better. Had nothing to do with that. They just thought that the first scene might be better when we first meet, if we did it overlapping and talking to each other. And it was just an opportunity. I don't even know whether or not they use that. Nevertheless, my insecurity was. And I said earlier, if you want to be an actor, my advice is don't go be late. And the reason why is because if you are an actor, you're always going to want to be better. What I told you about Kathy Bates, the ride home, you're going to want to do it better. You're going to want to, gosh, why didn't I do that? Why didn't, when you make a movie, I'm sure, you go, oh God, yeah. Why didn't I do that? Why didn't I cover it from this angle? An artist will always want to be better. You're not going to. It's not real life. It's art. As much as you want it to be real life, you can get close to real life, but it's not. It's a framed form of real life. Documentaries are real life. You just pray that the cameras are on, but we're actors and writers and stuff like that. So why didn't I do it better? And that should kill you. That type of regret could kill you. It should affect you. And it always does. And the reason why I was going to say that was I can't remember. But in any case, that's why. Oh, because of the crystal ball, you're going to be dissatisfied. The scene down in the canyon with the orbs, with the memory balls, when I did that, I must have done it 20 or 25 times. And I kept saying, no, let me try it again. I tried doing it with tears. I tried doing it not with tears. And I could cry like that because the moment when I did it over and over. And the reason why is because that scene affected me so much, and there was a purity to it. And I said that I wanted to relive it, and I felt good. It wasn't that I thought I could do better, probably. You can always do better of reality, and therefore, let me do it again, let me do it again. You will never get it, because it's not real, you're acting. Okay? Are you performing?
Well, I worked with Slim Pickens. And
oh, of course you did, of course.
And one of the greatest scenes in cinema is Slim riding the atomic bomb down to the So he said that Cooper shot it with him literally upside down, holding on to the bomb. And he was throwing up all day. They did 30 takes. They used the first one.
Really?
Yeah. That is one of the most famous shots.
They used the first one, but you didn't bet that Kubrick shot.
Yeah.
And the famous story, when Warren Beatty was shooting something, and it was out in country, nobody. And Warren Beatty, perfectionist, let's do it again. And he turned to, I think the cinematographer was famous, Conrad Hall or whoever it was. And he looks, he goes, "You think we got it?" He goes, "Yeah, take one." But,
Yeah, but and the same on Bugsy. It was a close-up.
Right.
And he kept asking, can we do it again? And Barry Levinson was directing. And about after take 10, he goes to the cinematographer, he said, "Where's Barry?" He said, "He left." He said, "Warren will know when he's got it." And that taught him a lesson too.
Oh,
wow. So Barry just left and he had it. Well, it's Warren Beatty.
Yeah.
Okay. Norman has often told us that if we stay in New York, it'll make us some better writers. Do you find as an actor it's really helped you to have more opportunity because there's more
density? It's the opposite. I don't know about the opportunity. LA is the land of milk and honey. But part of it is giving up your soul. Part of it is having to be in LA. Part of it is the work is better here. But LA is the land of milk and honey. Shit gets produced there. I really do believe that. But good stuff does too. Look, the thing is, there's good theater in LA. What there aren't are theaters and audiences. But the theater's pretty good. It really is. There's good actors out there, and they go and they want to work. It's good stuff, but nobody comes to see it. And the physical property that they need, a good theater, there's one, two, maybe three. The Taper's one of my favorites. But otherwise, it's not here. Legions of theaters. Great spaces, great views, acoustics, everything. I also don't think, here, you all live in New York, right? And you interact with people. And one of the reasons why I moved here, knowing that I could play golf whenever I want to, and knowing that the sun will always shine, and I could probably make more money, certainly in animation I could, but I chose to have my kids raised here, because when my kids go downstairs, they have to say hello to the doorman. LA, you don't gotta say no hello to nobody. You just get in your car and you go to where you have to go and you just don't interact, and it is an insidious evil in LA. You don't know what's up down, you don't know the seasons, it just flows by. I always say LA is like going on vacation. And when you come home, you look at the newspaper, you go, "Oh my God, look what went on. Oh my God, look what I missed." It's what it's like. That's what living in LA is. It's calm, and it's beautiful, it's wonderful, it's easy. And to me, life is not easy. That's the first thing. And when the wind blows, you got to go out and stand. Oh, you would still walk ahead. The wind doesn't blow in LA.
Yeah. My favorite Mel Brooks quotes, it was once asked, "What does a Jew need?" And he said, "A Jew needs a lobby."
Oh, God.
when you said that lobby, a doorman, to say hello to a doorman,
right.
And people congregate,
and you have this. Yeah, in LA, you do not. But Mel lives in LA, but you get out, you got. I'm drawing LA in very broad strokes, but you will interact with people here. And I will tell you this, I think it was Neil Simon and or what do you have? This is really important. This is something that I tell people too. The journey is often a lot more fun than the success or the end of the journey. It just is. It's more enriching. You try harder, you feel younger, you feel better. And Woody Allen cannot sit on a park bench and people watch. But when he was young, I bet he loved it. And Neil Simon couldn't interact anonymously or watch people like he wanted to. Success can ruin somebody. I shouldn't say that, but just know that you're clawing your way, you're writing, you're going to that. It ain't so bad. In fact, it's great. And in hindsight, you will realize it was great. You got to know that. But like, and I think this is what you have, you got to be a shark, you got to move ahead. You know, a shark will die. Not you got to be a shark, but a shark must move, always go ahead. Or else they die. You always got to keep working. Got to keep on top of things. What else? Go ahead.
Okay, so I'm actually a newcomer to this industry. I got my start in novels. Norman found me in Writer's Digest Conference.
Wow.
And the reason I jumped at the opportunity to be here is because as a novelist, I've gotten, and as a fan of certain series, I've gotten sick and tired of seeing, you know, hooked to film projects that flopped and were just terrible. When they go right, they're amazing. When they go wrong, they're really bad.
Right.
So, as an actor, if you were given something that started off as a novel, it has a fan base, or a comic series, and it has a fan base, you know, there's expectations for these characters and these storylines and everything. How do you approach that? Do you look at the source material, or do you just say, I'm going to come in and be me, and just look at the script in front of me? Like, how do you approach that?
Well, first of all, let me start off with my opinion, and then I will tell you about the second part. So remind me, Harry Master George, just remind me of that. But because of TV nowadays, I think that novels can work just as good as TV miniseries as they will as a book. I think Mildred Pierce is a great example of that. It was first made as a movie, which is really only famous because Joan Crawford was great in it and it addressed a woman's world. But the most recent version here took you through the whole thing. I think that if you were to look at one of my favorite books, if you haven't read it, it's great. It reads like a Jacqueline Suzanne novel, and it's written by John Steinbeck. It's East of Eden, all about hookers and killing, and the brother wants more. It's fantastic and dirty, really dirty. I can't wait. They tried to do it on network TV as a form. The movie with James Dean only covers about the last 80 pages is fantastic. And I think that if HBO was, I use HBO because they're the most famous of them, but if you could do an 8-part series and really delve into what a book could be, I think that they will be as good as the novel. No movie will ever be as good as the novel of art. I shouldn't say that. Now, but I used to remember my mom saying to me, the book is always better than the movie. The book is always better than the movie. And her example for the only movie that was ever better was Peyton Place. She said, that was a better movie than the book. But there are hope for books. Now, in answering your question, all the answers you need, this was taught to me by this teacher named Harry Master George, is in the script. Every single answer you need is in the script. Because acting is playing pretend. And that's why sometimes if a kid is open with his emotions, when you see a kid walking down the street screaming because he doesn't want to go to wherever he's going, that is a pure, he hasn't got the words to describe why he doesn't want to go. It's pure emotion. When a baby is drinking or tasting something and spits it out, what does the baby do? Describe what he does. He cries, right? Pure emotion. Can't explain it. Something is wrong in his life, and he's not happy. And his emotion is pure. Pure. Really pure. If you're playing in the playground, as, and I'm going to give you the example, this is over 20, 25 years ago, and you're playing Christopher Columbus and Queen Isabella, are you asking yourself, well, what does Queen Isabella's bedroom look like? And Queen Isabella, did she ever have any lesbian tendencies? Is she in love with Christopher Columbus? You ask none of that. You play Christopher Columbus and Queen Isabella. Hey, can I go to America? Yeah, whatever. You're not asking yourself all of these questions. Is it purity? It's playing pretend. All of the questions are there in the script. That's what I believe. But study the script a lot. Pour over the script. Over and over. Ask questions about in the thing. Don't go to any literal source or anything like that. They're all there. What the emotions are. That's what I believe.
So then you disagree with Alan Rickman asking J.K. Rowling, what's this guy's deal when he was cast in Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone?
No, I do believe that. I believe that. I believe this. What does he want? Mm-hmm. I believe in questions about what somebody wants and what's his deal. I mean, I was also taught that in a scene, this is really important. What's the most important thing in a scene? What is the most, in any scene, in any play, movie, TV show, what's the most important thing in any scene for an actor? It's the most important thing. You'll never get it, but keep throwing things out there. Go ahead.
I was going to say to reveal something.
Okay.
Reveal a truth.
What else? Anything else?
Move the story forward.
Anything else?
Face conflict.
For the actor, it should be that they're in the scene.
They have lines.
That you believe yourself.
The motion, go ahead.
The want.
That's getting closer.
Yeah, that's the
one. That is, but what is the most important thing then? Where can you put your finger on?
Are you goal?
Close, but what's the most important thing? The other person. Without the other person, you can't get your want. You can't get your need. The other person gives you your need. Does that make sense? You can't, otherwise you're alone. Why not live life alone? Because you can't. Why have a scene? There's no reason to have a scene. The other person is the only thing that's important in the scene. You want something, the other person will give it to you.
You know, forget Michael Mann and the film Heat. And that famous scene between Al Pacino and De Niro. They were never in the scene together.
You have no idea how I hate that scene.
Okay.
Do you like that scene?
It was historical because they never worked. These two tyros had never
worked together.
Yeah, never.
I hate that scene so much because I was in an acting class with Italian guys who like to strut and pick up women, and they would act like this. Give me, anybody have a book or anything? Well, okay. Hey. Oh, wait. I'm good. You? It's like they it was so method that they took what they were saying, they digested it. They said, okay, now I gotta get it up. Now I'll talk. It had nothing to do. They, I swear to God, I think the only one that they had in the thing is I gotta be better than him. Because they were the two.
But they were not in the seat when you said the other person.
I know.
It wasn't even there.
Yeah, I hated that.
Well, maybe that's why. Maybe that's why.
And I've seen people like that. They're acting. And they're acting for themselves. They're acting, you know, a lot of times, what was the shooting the other day? Or maybe I was working on something. And somebody was saying, that, you know, about crying or something, but maybe it's not apropos. The actor wants to feel it, and it's like, screw the audience, screw the other person. I want to feel it. If I feel it, then you'll feel it. That's not always true. So I don't. In that very famous scene, I do not like that scene. I really don't like that scene. I want it so much more, when those two guys met.
Go to the scene with Christopher Walken in True Romance, and that scene, and those two guys had a meet, and that's one of the greatest scenes I've ever.
The greatest scenes ever. Oh, it's so good. Oh my God, it's great.
You know the scene we're talking about?
Is that the one with the grandfather's
Dennis, the Christopher Walken
and Harvey Keitel.
No. That was Dennis.
Dennis Farina? No.
No.
Dennis Hopper?
Dennis Hopper.
Yeah,
and Dennis Hopper's son is off with
a
load of cocaine. It's a scene, and Dennis Hopper is going to die. There's no two ways about it. And he's across from this Christopher Walken, a mafiosi, and he's going to die. And he is so brave in this scene, and basically having a cigarette, and is telling the star that he's the lowest form on earth. This mafiosi who's holding his life to himself.
Right, right.
And it's a fabulous scene.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. And it couldn't be. And Harvey Keitel couldn't say that unless Christopher Walken were there in the scene.
Yeah.
Of course. And that really is. And actually, that is like the first thing that I could have told you about writing is that intersects with what I believe about acting is the other person in the scene or the other people in the scene is. And I am not a writer by any means, but as an actor, I'm saying that's the most important thing in any scene, I think. And it intersects with wants and what is your goal and stuff like that. But you can't get anything without the other person. What else? Anything else? Yeah, go ahead.
Which shows do you find yourself drawn to? Which television shows?
Well, I got kids. I now tend to fall asleep when I start watching because I'm so exhausted. You know, I can talk about the old shows that I love that you guys don't know, but I loved the Van Dyke Show when I was growing up. I loved it. I encourage you all to watch it. And you know what Carl Reiner did and he about keeping it so up to date is that there was rarely a modern reference in the show. The only modern reference I could pick up by going out on a date, Rosemarie was either going to see The Music Man or My Fair Lady. She had tickets to Music Man. It's the only there was no mention of the president. There was no mention of the best hamburgers around. It was just what happened. There was never anything. And I think that's what keeps it so so brilliant.
But you worked on Seinfeld.
I never worked on Seinfeld.
Oh, you did? Well,
I never did. I asked myself to be fired. Did I end the story? I was fired. Yeah, okay, I was fired. But I asked to be fired. Doing Curb Your Enthusiasm, let me tell you about improvisation and doing Curb Your Enthusiasm. I've done about 5 or 6 movies that are improv. Larry David. How to write for a show that's improvised. Not saying he knows how to improvise, because there are better improvisers than he. But you got a half hour Curb Your Enthusiasm episode. Half hour. He writes a scenario. That scenario is 16 to 17 pages long. It has detail after detail after detail. And I did a movie that was improvised. And that was 26 pages long. There's art and an artfulness that Larry David has in trying to get his finished product that other writers, they don't. They're scribbling it off and they say, okay, this scene is the scene where I did a movie about poker playing. This is the scene where Andy, I think, let's call my character Andy. Andy beats Texas Slim, or whoever it is, the most famous. And we're supposed to shoot that and have the dialogue and everything. But what is our want in the scene? I don't want to be told what happens in the scene. What happens with the characters? What is the want? Why is the other person there? Granted, it shows that I'm lucky and I just get to do, or maybe I'm not. It takes a lot more than just, hey, let's write this and let's go shoot this scene. Larry sets it all down with such detail, such specificity, which is why it's difficult for him to do so many seasons. To write a shooting is easy, honest to God. And Hitchcock used to say that. Hitchcock said that, you know, he would make the, he would have the movie shot by shot. He would know what the movie looked like before they ever got on set. Shooting it was easy, and then you got to edit it and try editing thousands of feet of film when you've improvised and you do this scene, that scene, what joke worked funny and everyone. That's tough. But what you need is a really good script supervisor and somebody to sit next to and go, that was good, remember, take four. That's where the work is. In fact, that's where, we can't say that's where Larry works best, but it's what he does do well. Actually, often he doesn't do it best because he'll choose what's good for him rather than what's good in the scene. Not always, but sometimes. Yeah, what else?
If you have enough faith in your actors, and actors have enough faith in their craft, you can make shit up. And in the best way, I worked with an actor named Matt Frewer.
Great.
And I said, do the script. Let's get the script down and then go crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And in every scene, and I know he did some thinking, it was a thrill for me as a director to see this, what's going to happen? You're going to make me laugh? And every time he did.
I have a question. How many of those takes did you lose?
How many of
the tapes? Of the tapes? Did he change the words, or he just became inventive with his acting?
Change the words, change the idea.
You did use those tapes?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, because I'm on a show called Red Oaks, which I really recommend. Nobody knows that it exists. It's really good. It's on Amazon Prime. You get a chance. It's really, really, really good. Second season started Friday. People don't even know that the first season was done. Some improvising that would go on. Some by a really, really brilliant comic mind. A lot of times, the script is going, you were lucky. You were really lucky. In this movie that I mentioned, there was it's the name of it, it's called The Grand. And this wonderful, wonderful, wonderful writer wrote the scenario. But it was a short scenario. It could be based on movie. And he's a really great writer. He's not a good writer, he's great. And we got a few people to play minor roles. One of them was Ray Romano. Raymond looked at it, and he was smart enough, he's so good and so funny, that he was able to bring in the best character in the movie with funny lines that are so obtuse, so fun. And you hope maybe every actor with a thing could have such imagination. We had Michael McKean. His character, who was great, minor role. His character wasn't really as good as Ray's. Ray came, oh my God, he came up with being a guy who had a support group, and would meet with people who were hit by lightning, who were struck by lightning. It was hilarious. And his fertile and brilliant mind was able to come up with stuff that Zach never could. And my mind doesn't work as brilliantly as that. And he was hilarious. He wants to what he wanted. His wife was a champion poker player. She was getting all the attention, but he was saying, "Well, man, you know, I had this group with him." And it was hilarious. Absolutely funny.
There's only a character like that on Better Call Saul, who is deathly afraid of anything electric.
Michael McKean.
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant.
Yeah.
Brilliant. Yeah. Well, he's great. But that's all in the writer's mind. Yeah, he's acting with the right.
I don't want you. I don't want to wear you out. And
I'm fine. I don't want to wear you out. I can believe you. I can talk to you. This is good for my ego. I was saying I like acting. I like being in front of the.
What do you look for, and how do you like get ready for a script like a series? Man? But when it's so like kind of almost metaphorical,
actually,
literary.
Serious Man is really good. I will tell you that I did use my imagination for that. You know, I used to work at Second City in Chicago, and there were some crazies walking around Second City. They were the refuse of the world and were given a home. There was a guy named Clark who used to be the bartender there, and. There was no more brilliant guy. You know, I mean, I used to talk like that, and, you know, he'd always had a glass of eyes filled with vodka, and he would just keep looking at and the most brilliant. He'd know, you ask him about anything, he knew it all. So I looked at that. I sort of, you know, sort of looked at that, thought of him. Here's an interesting thing. There was a guy who I was in the show, and he later on went literally crazy, literally had to go to a home. He's now a lawyer, but he was an actor at Second City. Brilliant, 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 funny, weird mind. I'd love to hear what he says about Trump right now, because he's so darkly, darkly funny, darkly funny. And he had some sort of synapse problem, and he would imagine a guy standing here like this, but this is what was going on. And then he'd walk away. They would go, and he would stand by the wall for like 4 to 7 seconds and do this, and then walk away. It was fine. Not that affected anybody, but how weird. And so the Coen brothers usually don't have rehearsal for their movies, but for some reason we had a read through and we rehearsed for a couple of days before we did the movies. And I would say to the brothers, I go, you know, there's this guy, Rick Thomas, who acted like this, and it's so weird, and it's normal, but it's not normal. Maybe we could do it. Yeah, that sounds great, that sounds great. So, and Joel said, yeah, think of a place where we can do it. So, we're doing the scene that's in the hotel room where I'm sitting waiting up. And they say, okay, sit on the side of the bed and just cry. And I said to Joel, you know, I was thinking maybe this is the place where we could be, where we could do that. And he goes, yeah, okay, let's see if it works. And the camera was set up at the bed, but I went up to the wall like that. He goes, yeah, you know, I didn't think it would ever work, but yeah, okay, let's use that. He had no intention of using that, but it happened to fit in, and he thought it was good, and that's sometimes how the Coen brothers work. On the flip side, they work, I think they know what their movie looks like before.
I'm sure you saw the original version of One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Yes.
Downtown.
Oh, you mean the stage?
The stage show.
Oh, okay. With Kirk Douglas?
And there were, yeah, there were people that, like Danny DeVito, and there was one gray-haired man who just danced. He was in the film, so he just did a ballroom dance around him. And I'm sure he just looked at this stuff. It was an insane asylum. But it was so beautiful, and this all was going on. And then, ironically, that hotel that they staged in fell down, if you remember, downtown.
I never saw the play.
Oh,
it was too
yes. William DeVay.
Yes, that's right, DeVay, yes.
Great cast. That a lot of them were in the film.
Right, yeah.
But from a book to the stage to a film.
Yeah.
About your question about it, adaptiveness. This, and I think maybe... To that question, maybe one of the adaptations that might have been better than the book, even though the book was good, is Godfather.
Oh, absolutely. Oh my God. The Godfather is a great piece of art. The book is pulp.
Yes,
absolutely. And Godfather 2, heads and tails, even, yeah, of course. Oh my God, what an obvious choice.
Yeah.
Obvious.
Yeah.
Bible is another example. Okay.
So,
what else? Anything else? Did I ask you a question? About Serious Man?
Yeah.
But I of course had a great want to talk about a lot.
Right.
You know, I knew who this guy was. It was that all he wanted to do was not be him. You know, to say he accepted who he was. And, it was such a good movie. Yeah. Very proud of that. Yeah. Anything else?
I'm getting you out of here because this was fabulous. Okay.
I have one more question.
All right.
just another one that like you might not be able to put an exact finger on. But in all like the sitcoms you've done, just asking that from like a person that wants to write funny comedy scripts, are there any like times where you find your character saying like the most cliche joke or just dumb?
It's a great question. I can answer you in. It's a very, very, very great question. When I was on Spin City, after about 2.5-3 years, I asked to be fired. I would have no arc in a show when I described one of the first things I talked about, literally a quarter of a page. I knew what my goal was in the show, and that's to get laughs. But I had no dramatic hook, okay? Ted Knight on Mary Tyler Moore asked the same thing on the Mary Tyler Moore show. He asked to be fired. He couldn't stand walking down the street being insulted that he was stupid and a fool and a buffoon and a clown, and he asked to be fired. I did not always like Spit City. When it was really good, there were times where I think some of the best sitcoms you've ever, and my God, if you can write like this, and Norman, I think, will back me up. If you can write like Matt Heidke, who, in my opinion, writes like Larry David, in that he grades things. They're all farces that make sense. And farce is the most difficult thing to write. And usually it's like, just go in that other door! Why don't you open the door? You know, it's usually there's an elephant in the room that they ignore. Matt Hagen can write like that. Larry David can do that, but Spin City didn't always do that. They did take the easy way out with my character. Especially, it was, you know, and by the way, for an actor on a sitcom, I always say, go in and make your decisions big. Go, whatever they write, act it big. And Connie Britton, who was a brilliant actress on Friday Night Lights, brilliant on American Horror and Nashville, the whole thing, she couldn't get a handle on what she would have to do in Spin City. Part of it was the writing. But all she had to do was just give it her all, and maybe they would hook the writers. You got to make it easy for the writers. What are you made of? My character was not cheap. when the thing was first started, but they wrote one joke that I was able to land especially well. For 6 years, my character was cheap. It wasn't written that way. The Bible became that. But I got sick and tired of doing the cheap. You just get tired. And that's why I go from plays to movies to this to that. I mean, I'll do it all. I love any genre. They always ask, "What do you like, comedy or drug?" And I like it all.
You're not going to leave New York. What happens if they ask you to do a series in California?
Well, you go do the series. You go where the work is. Okay. But my family stays here, and I go back and forth.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
No, I'm talking about life as a life. I mean, Jeffrey, take your time with that. He lives here, but.
Well, yeah, he has to go back and forth. Alan Alda did it for 11 years. By the way, one thing I didn't finish about doing a sitcom is that here you have these 5 easy days. You have that for 3 weeks, and then you get a week off. You get a week off. So you go from August until March, you work 3 weeks, and you get a week off, maybe 2 weeks at Christmas. It's the easiest life in the world. You do an hour show, you go from July until May, every single day, working from 6, 7 in the morning until 6, 7, 8 at night. That's, like, when you take a look at the people who we grew up, like Jack London on Quincy, he was Quincy, or Peter Falk. Well, now Peter Falk, God, only had to do like 12 a year, but, you know, when these character, when a show was named after a character, when that character had to be there, 5 days a week all that time. I just don't know how they did it. I'm not kidding. I don't understand.
You know, Peter Falk came to when he got that, created that character before it was written. And he went to Elaine May and he said, give me some character tips. She said, never take off the raincoat.
That's fantastic.
That's, wow. I mean, that's
great.
I never take off the radio.
Yeah.
And every time he came in a room,
that's
radio.
I never did that.
And a stupid car, but it was all character.
Yeah.
And we're creating characters now. And these are things that we think are innocuous, but they're really important.
Oh, they are. They are. Yes. The detail of a character is what an actor. You see, if you told me that, that's what we hook into. It really is. That's and all of the answers are in the script. So put them in the script. Yeah. That makes sense? That's where the answers lay, in the script.
Yeah. Do you have a question?
Yes. Do you mind if we take a class picture with you?
I don't mind doing it.
Great. Well, thank you.